Hi, Roberto. I'm Nicole Killian.
Hi, Nicole. I'm Roberto Ventura. Nicole, where did you go to school?
I did my undergraduate studies at the Rochester Institute of Technology, and then I went to grad school at Cranbrook Academy of Art.
Awesome.
What about you?
I studied math physics at Albion College in Albion, Michigan for my undergrad, and then I got a master's degree in architecture at Miami of Ohio. That's the start of this journey.
How did you switch from math to architecture?
The great thing about studying at a small school for me was the ability to study lots of different things. I went to school thinking I was going to be one thing. I thought I was going to be an eye doctor, you know, like number one, number two. I think it was my high school girlfriend at the time. She's like, "Do you really want to do that your whole life?" And it just sent me on a spiral. And I just every semester, it's changing my major. But I kept coming back to architecture. I kept coming back. It just seemed something, every time I studied something, it would key me towards architecture. Mm-hmm. And finally, I remember like the senior before my senior year, like I'd even go to a movie, and the movie happened to be, it was Sleepless in Seattle. And like, the main character is an architect. And it was just like beating me over the head, architecture, every time I turned around. And I thought, I gotta indulge this. Uh-huh. Really, within the first week of studying it, it was obvious. And that's how I found myself in that orientation. I studied math and physics partly out of default. It was a default major. I found myself at the end of my sophomore year, halfway done with it. It's fascinating.
That's like amazing that would be your default.
No, it's totally.
That would not be mine. I ran away from it as quickly as possible after high school.
And you know, high school, I had a really hard time with it. And I think having a second crack at it, there was something about it, like, I'm going to figure this out.
Uh-huh.
But also, the teachers there were fantastic. And the people I studied with were amazing people, brilliant mm-hmm. people, the kind of people who like build computers for fun.
Yeah.
I was not one of those people. I studied with an actual astronaut. He became an astronaut last year.
That's
The year after, amazing. I think NASA stopped sending people to space, he became an astronaut. And so I was surrounded with brilliant people. Studying things that I didn't understand, it took me a lot of effort to like scrape through. But I think what it helped me with, it was like a rigor of thinking and a rigor of process.
Mm-hmm.
Because I soon recognized I could survive in studying math and physics if I could get the basics of the process. If I didn't get the answer right, that's okay. But if my process was going the right way, I would be rewarded for the process. And that served me well. In the meantime, I was taking art classes because I really loved art. But you know, I had my grandfather's voice in my head, "What are you going to do with an art degree?"
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't know. But yeah. The irony is that you could do more with an art degree than the degree I actually got. Because it's like half math and half physics, which is not enough to do anything in either of those. I was indulging my real passion while I was kind of doing this other thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was a natural progression that way. How did you end up?
Strangely, it was pretty linear. Mm-hmm. I never like switched majors or thought about any other majors. Maybe at one point at RIT, I thought I was going to double major in glass and graphic design.
What stopped that?
I think I just couldn't make it work with the classes I had to take. But I really liked, at the time I felt like I wasn't using my hands enough in graphic mm-hmm. design. And so it was very much on the computer in the early 2000s. Mm-hmm. Like we started, you know, like hand drawing letters, but other than that, we went straight into programs.
Right.
And so that really like satiated what I was missing in my design classes. Mm-hmm. But I really liked art in high school, and then this sort of default idea of graphic design at the time was like, mm-hmm. Well, I really like magazines and CDs.
Right.
And I can design both of those things if I go into graphic design. So that was my like naive understanding of what I could do.
Did you have a moment when you started studying where like that like popped, like that bubble of what you thought it was, like pow?
Not really while I was at RIT. Uh-huh. Maybe I took classes with teachers that I could kind of do what I wanted. Uh-huh. Like I knew that the teachers I had would allow me to kind of reframe the projects that they were assigning to me. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we'd have a project where it was making an image, but I would decide that instead of tacking up images mounted to foam core, you'd have to look at the images like, it's so hokey, but like, you know, in a box where there's like other objects that you have to like reckon with, uh-huh. you know, stuff like that. But so I felt like those moments were really good for me, yeah. where my teachers just were like, oh yeah, why don't you just try that? Like, as long as you fulfill the like basic requirements of the project,
right.
and you can explain to me why you did this, mm-hmm. then you can totally sort of explore it in a different way.
Yeah, that kind of, I think recognizing that option is there as a student was really key.
Yeah.
You know, that you can pursue an agenda with a project,
yeah.
even if it's not to the letter of what's going on.
And I felt like it was just about me asking,
yeah.
which was sort of a weird threshold, I think, to cross mm-hmm. at first. But yeah. then it just like allowed me to kind of try other things. Mm-hmm. So, and I was hanging out with people in photo and the crafts departments, yeah. and my roommate was a painter. So I was spending most of my time with people that weren't graphic designers. Mm-hmm. And so then I was thinking about like, how can I kind of take what you're doing and think about it in what I'm doing, yeah. and vice versa? Mm-hmm.
I think being able to kind of mingle with other people, non-designers or other types of designers, was really important. And for me, in undergrad, there were no design departments. It's all liberal arts. So philosophy, art, biology, chemistry. It was. You have the opportunity to kind of understand the way things are interrelated.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's where the real kind of excitement happens, is kind of making new connections through those things.
Yeah.
We've got a bunch of slides. Should we look at?
Yeah. So. Actually, okay, so.
Sure.
Do I have to press the?
I think the right.
The right
button.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so I took screenshots from your website.
Sure.
And I think the first thing that I was looking at were these statements mm-hmm. that you had up,
yeah.
about designing smart,
mm-hmm.
and sort of defining that for yourself. Yeah. And I wonder, like, do you see this as a personal manifesto? Is it something that you talk about a lot in your classes? Because mm-hmm. it was funny to me, because there's this whole like trend in graphic design and maybe in interior design, sure. where it's like, I'm gonna think wrong and I'm gonna like disrupt the space. Uh-huh. And like, I really liked that you just said design smart.
Yeah.
Cause I thought that was very, I don't know, I just think it's so much more thoughtful.
Well thank you. I think for me as a designer, when I was trying to establish my practice, I think one of the things I hate are design mission statements. Because every mission statement is like, we give shape to our clients' visions. Like, everyone should do that. What's distinguishing about that? And I was trying to make a reminder of things to myself, really, more than anything. And that, like, for the first thing, like being bold.
Mm-hmm.
I think as a designer, especially in practice, where you start to have, when you start to look at the bottom line, and it's like, I got to pay the bills. It's real easy to retreat into a safe place.
Mm-hmm.
And boldness is kind of a reminder that that's a temporary fix. That's a temporary self. If you do that, eventually you'll find yourself down the road cutting yourself off at the knees all mm-hmm. the time. You're not going to entertain the things that are unconventional. You're not going to entertain the things that are improper. And so like those things are reminders to me. You got to be responsible, and it's a responsibility when you design spaces or buildings. you're impacting communities, like physically and metaphorically. As soon as you put something in, there's an architecture firm that I always admired called Banish. They're from Germany. And anytime you build something, you're removing something from a community. You know, it may have been an empty space, but now it's being occupied. And so there's a responsibility to contribute to that substitution. Mm-hmm. Whether it's the way you use materials, the way you use systems, whether it's the way you engage your community, you have to be responsible. You can't work in a vacuum. And so this for me was like a series of reminders for myself, a little mantra to keep in mind, mm-hmm. and hopefully kind of explain to people who want to work with me, these are the expectations I have for myself. Mm-hmm. And it's okay if we don't work together that way. But I want you to know that up front before we go too far down the road.
I guess the thing that was like through the images that I chose, mm-hmm. I chose images, I guess it'll be maybe an overarching thing that I ask you about, but like thinking about how you have a background in architecture, mm-hmm. and then now you also practice in interior design, mm-hmm. and teach interior design, like there's such a different conversation there than traditional graphic design, where like there's a relationship to bodies, mm-hmm. like bodies in space, and right. what that like relationship of scale and mm-hmm. like movement is. And mm-hmm. So the first image I pulled was, I feel like, probably the most recognizable for people on the campus, sure. that we walk by every day. The ICA, it's called the Hive?
They used to call it the Hive. I don't know if they call it the Hive anymore, but okay. it's kind of like where all the buzzing activity was going on. So so that might be a little antiquated right now. That was not my, that was the way they described themselves.
Gotcha. So.
But it was better than the facade study at 818 West Broad
right,
Street.
Right, right. So. But I was wondering, I feel like this is such, it was really refreshing when this went up, because I felt like it was such a graphic way to approach Broad Street and sort of stand out amongst sort of the cacophony of stuff.
And that was the primary challenge with it. This, I should preface this, and I think there are a couple other slides in the deck of some other studies for the interior. Mm-hmm. But the ICA approached me about working with them to do some identity for their exterior and interior. And specifically, I'd worked with some students to do an exhibit design a couple years before that.
And with MOB?
With MOB.
The middle of Broad Street.
Exactly. And so the idea was that I could mentor a MOB group through this process. So we worked with, I think, 7 students from the middle of Broad Studio. I think fall of 2014, we did a series of exterior studies and a series of interior studies. At December, that group fractures. They go back to different departments. And then they get ready for their senior projects, and then they graduate. Mm-hmm. And so we really got to the beginning part, the beginning discussion. And so after that semester, I kind of continued the dialogue with ICA and then took the students' initial ideas and refined it mm-hmm. into this study. One of the challenges for this is that it's really not the best building in the world. I don't know if you guys remember when it was, what it used to be? Ramekins? Yeah. And so it's kind of a goofy little building. It doesn't relate at all to any of the other buildings.
That would have been like an awesome problem to solve. Like, it's going to be an office called The Hive and a taco shop.
That may have been.
What do you do?
That was the marketing thing that we missed, frankly.
missed opportunity.
Absolutely. Because nothing's going to get people in there like a taco shop. it's kind of a weird little building. It's got this formality, but it's a very wimpy formality. Mm-hmm. Scale-wise, it's right next to the depot, so it can't compete with that. Mm-hmm. And frankly, the head shop next door overwhelms it too. And the head shop next door is more attentive to a Broad Street kind of scale than anything. Uh-huh. So part of our challenge is how do you work with that? And then also speak to an automotive scale, because it's really, Broad Street right there is really an automobile scale, mm-hmm. as well as a pedestrian scale. And so kind of negating the whole facade and treating it as a surface, mm-hmm. I think was the part that got the project moving forward. Mm-hmm. The thing that I thought was most refreshing about it is that the first couple of times I met with people on campus and talked about the feasibility of putting this hot pink gradient on a building, I thought like the campus architects and people would be like, that's a great idea, and then kind of shelve it. But everyone was really excited about it. The campus architecture people, they were like, this would be fantastic. I met with a signage lady, the woman who does all the signs for offices throughout the campus. Mm-hmm. She was like, oh, this would be great. And so the support from top to bottom was really fantastic. And as they were putting it up, kind of seeing people post things was really, really exciting too. Mm-hmm. So it was a really gratifying process to kind of be a little bold with something and have kind of the response. From a designer's point of view, I think the worst thing is like a neutral response.
Yeah.
You either want people to hate it or you want people to love it.
Yeah.
But that kind of meh is the worst thing. And it hasn't been a meh thing, which has been fantastic.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's holding up like really nicely. How long has it been up now, like 2 years?
I think it's only been up a year, actually.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, I just feel like every time I go by it, it still has a really nice vibrancy as everything else is kind of changing around it and storefronts, you know.
And the people who set these colors, I mean, when the sky is blue and you look up at it, it's the most beautiful kind of palette of colors. It's just fantastic. I love it.
We need to take a photo of your sneakers
in front of it
and be like perfect.
That has to happen. That has to happen.
Before yeah. like they get dirty at all.
Absolutely.
Okay, so I took another screenshot of text.
Okay.
Because I like language and awesome. I was kind of drawn to a lot of just the statements. Mm-hmm. And I think this might have been, was this part of your thesis? Was that part?
Sorry.
That's all right.
Was this statement part of your thesis?
That probably was, yeah.
Yeah. And so I thought maybe you could talk a little bit about how you got to talking about culture, maybe mm-hmm. like in architecture school. Mm-hmm. Is that something that's at the forefront of what you study? Because I know, at least in the way we're teaching graphic design, mm-hmm. we try to talk about, I think, visual culture yeah. as a whole. And. Mm-hmm. That's very different than the way I studied. Yeah. Like, we didn't talk about culture at mm-hmm. all. Mm-hmm. And so I wonder, like, is that always embedded into?
Well, I think it comes out of studying, going to a liberal arts school first.
Yeah.
As opposed to starting off in design school. In design school, and the curriculum is so jam-packed with information. And it's information you have to know, and it's technical, it's critical, it's historical. And there isn't really much opportunity to talk about all the things that influence building. When we study history, we study a lot of history primarily through the artifacts that are extant. And yeah. a lot of that is architecture. And so architecture reflects the values that we have. Any built object, any designed object reflects some value of that culture. And for me, that informed the way I studied, or the way I evolved, you know, in that 18 to 22 kind of, where your world, you go to school, everything you thought you knew kind of gets flipped on its head, and you're suddenly looking at things totally differently. And for me, that was fascinating. That was the most exciting part of school, is just learning other ways of thinking and learning the other kind of viewpoints. I went to school, I was a good student in high school, and I got to college, and I realized there were people a lot smarter than me, and there were things I'd never considered before, and it was fascinating. But in architecture school, things are so jammed together, there's not much opportunity to explore that. And so for me, it was really important to find a way to bring that into how we study architecture. Because if you study architecture just from a building point of view, this is what the building looks like, this is what the building symbolizes, this is how it's put together, you're kind of missing the connection it has to culture and society. And I came through school at a time where like Foucault and like deconstruction, they're influencing a lot of the discussion. Critical theory, interdisciplinary studies, this is all kind of becoming new at that point. And if you're not drawing upon all these different kind of influences, then you're missing something. Mm-hmm. Things are kind of half-made. But in school, there's really, in design schools, there's not much time to look at that. So this is my attempt to kind of critique the studio. As great as studio is, I think studio is the best way to study.
Yeah.
We have to invite other voices into the studio if we're really going to understand how built culture impacts culture. So.
Yeah, I'm kind of curious about how that intersects with, like, when I think about architecture, mm-hmm. even looking at the ICA building,
absolutely.
It takes a long time to design a structure mm-hmm. and then to actually build it and yeah. have it be structural and stable and yeah. lasting. Like, thinking about how that intersects with culture mm-hmm. when culture is changing.
Yeah.
I feel like that's like a lot to, like, wrap your head around, like, as you're, because graphic design, mm-hmm. I mean, graphic design changes mm-hmm. so quickly. I mean, what we, especially like now, what we see online, like the next day can be completely different.
Right.
But architecture doesn't necessarily have that.
No, it
base.
Doesn't. Yeah, architecture moves a lot more slowly. And it's just, I don't know if there's a way around that.
Yeah.
And so I think some of the more interesting transgressive practices are ones that are engaging other kind of media, mm-hmm. Which are more nimble with attacking things.
Mm-hmm.
There's also more resistance, I think, to architecture because it's a permanent element, because it impacts people's neighborhoods. People seem to be a lot less willing to experiment with that. People are willing to experiment with dress, with cars, with eating, lifestyle. People are interested, will try lots of different things, but building, partially because the permanence, partially because of the investment, they're like, that's where they kind of pump the brakes a little bit.
Yeah.
And so this project over here was an installation project, which is quicker, it's faster, it's more nimble, and it's easier to kind of address something at the moment. And one of the things that I'm interested in now in design is a way that design can be more attentive to the speed that which with which things change. And mm-hmm. so I'm really interested in graphic elements, video elements, and how they become building elements.
Mm-hmm.
But this was an opportunity to kind of critique the studio culture, an opportunity to kind of established a moment where we could have a dialogue. We had just moved into a brand new architecture building, and one of the rules of the architecture building was don't put anything on the walls, which is the most like counterproductive thing you can have in a design school, because they didn't want to ruin the building, they just got it.
Uh-huh.
And so this is my opportunity to say, we need to have a dialogue about what we're doing now. Now that we're back in this building all together, we had been fractured in lots of different buildings. Now we've got a community again, but we haven't really talked about what it means to be back together.
Did you ask for permission or did you just do it?
I went to the campus architects and asked for permission and they said no. And so this was like 3 weeks before it was due. And so I was sitting in a little cubby in the rotunda. It's an old classical building in the rotunda, trying to find an alternative. And one of the teachers that I really respected walked by and said, "What are you doing?" And I said, well, I talked to the campus architect, I can't do this. And he said, why the hell did you do that? And I was like, he's like, just build it. And so I said, okay. Uh-huh. And so I was building it, and actually the chair of the department walked through while I was halfway done with a tour group.
Uh-huh.
And he's like, you got permission to do this, right? And I said, we're cool. And he walked by, uh-huh. and I went outside and I hyperventilated. and I came back in and just said, it's got to finish it now, you know? I asked for permission, I didn't get it, and I built it anyway, which for me was the most transgressive thing I'd ever done in my life.
That's awesome.
But it's also the best thing I ever done, so.
So, I saw this, and this is a this is like a diagram that's talking about your practice with a collaborator, right?
Yeah.
And so this idea of like concept to object and object to concept. Mm-hmm. So would you say that you sort of think through making, or are you making through thinking?
I collaborated with a friend of mine, Josh Poteet, who's a really fantastic poet, National Poetry Series winning poet. We've done a couple of installations. And I generally think and then make. Mm-hmm. I try to do some verbal analysis. Josh, even though he's a poet, he makes things and then reflects and figures out what it was. And so we both kind of come to the process from different points of view. Mm-hmm. And because I don't work that way, I'm kind of fascinated. I teach with people who work that way. They make, they reflect, they understand what they were doing all along. Mm-hmm. I've never been that way. Partially because I think I came to it through drawing instead of building. Mm-hmm. And so I'm kind of fascinated by that process. So I want to figure out how to do that more. I see it as a until I engage it more, I'm going to be kind of half the designer I could be. It may not be my native way of doing it, but I want to learn more. Mm-hmm. And so, and I think it's really ironic that a guy who makes his living with words kind of thinks about things more like a designer than a writer. Mm-hmm. And so it's, I think having that contrast is a really valuable thing in a collaboration. Mm-hmm. You just, more voices, more alternatives, I think gives you a better product almost every time. Mm-hmm. Almost every time. It's harder. It's way harder.
Yeah.
Because it requires you to coordinate things that when you're working by yourself, you don't have to think about coordinating. Just things like meeting time. Negotiating two different jobs and two different families and things like that. But it's ultimately incredibly rewarding. Mm-hmm. So this is back to the ICA project. And these are actually some student sketches.
Oh,
and
cool.
So going back to like the coordination collaboration, that's been kind of a goal of mine lately, is really starting to study collaboration. And because collaboration is not native, it's not intuitive. I think there's an assumption that we all know how to do it, so just go do it. Mm-hmm. But I don't think that's the case.
Is it more inherent in architecture and interior design, do you think? Because the scope of projects just requires different skill sets?
Absolutely. I think it's a very, very unique, rare practice where you're not collaborating or coordinating. Mm-hmm. And primarily because of the scale and the diversity of professions that are required for it. I worked for a year at a big international firm here in town doing healthcare interiors. And we would do things like just one operating room. And it would be like $1.5 million project. You would have so many people, like you'd have a special lighting designer. You would have a special designer who just does the rigging to hold the lights. You'd have so many specialists, and it's all contingent on coordinating all of that. Mm-hmm. And if you have no interest in that or no dexterity with it, it's just not going to happen. And in school, a lot of times we work in individual projects, and that's definitely important. It's important for people to explore and try to determine what their voice is. But I think it's also a really key time to start to develop skills that make collaborations and group work more rewarding. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of times people don't have a good experience doing group projects, and it turns them off that process. Mm-hmm. I'm learning, as working with students, I'm learning how to kind of structure better collaborations and how to kind of enact practices that will allow for better collaborations. And so I think these types of charrettes where the students are working together are great opportunities to learn that.
I'm teaching a class right now where, like, the first day of class, I said you would only be working in groups, and I said if you hate working in groups, you should take this class, and if you love working in groups, you should take this class. But We've been kind of checking in with each other, mm-hmm. I think, to see how it's going. Yeah. But I'd say so far it's gone pretty good, just because I think maybe we're trying to just feel out the amount of time that feels right to mm-hmm. either like let go of control or take control, and like what are those roles in a group. So we started with groups of three, and now we're doing there's three groups of five.
Yeah.
So, and that feels really big, I think, for everyone. But I think, I don't know, I think more of that needs to happen, because especially like graphic design, you can work by yourself.
Right.
There's collaboration in printing and mm-hmm. Fabrication, yeah. but you can go for a very long time without really ever having, you can have that mindset of like, I'm doing it all by myself. Yeah.
I'm frankly worried about working that way, working by myself, because I fool myself into thinking I've got it. And having that other person to as a check, it's such a valuable thing. It's such a valuable thing. Three seems to be a good number.
Yeah, like, I think three is a really good number.
Two people can agree out of coincidence, but three,
it's,
I don't want to rely on myself. I want to have someone else there.
I get sick of myself, so it's like, it's fun to have someone else who, there's like a surprise involved in collaboration,
absolutely.
Right? Like, because you can expect what you're going to do in mm-hmm. some ways, or you have these places that you always go for inspiration or stuff like that, but if you're collaborating with someone who's either of a different discipline mm-hmm. or lives in a different place, they're inherently going to have a different point of view and surprise you.
And in fact, with the work I did with my friend Josh, the poet, each time we've brought in a third voice, they haven't been a direct collaborator, but they've been someone who's influenced our work. And that's been the fuel that's kind of moved the project.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that surprise, it's really hard to kind of contrive that by yourself.
Cool.
So, but this is more, you know, the other great thing about the students kind of collaborating with students is they bring things to the table that I'm not going to think about, you know, the surprise.
Yeah.
Perfect segue right over here. I have, when I structure something, I have an idea where I think it's going to go. And no matter how much I structure that, the students always interject something that I don't anticipate.
Mm-hmm.
And that's always the most interesting part of the process. If it went exactly the way I thought it would be, it'd be incredibly dull. And I don't think teaching would be that interesting.
Mm-hmm.
But that variable that comes into it, that's what makes the job exciting. That's what makes the design life intriguing. So mm-hmm. This was another one of the collaborations that my friend Josh and I did. And I was curious how you chose this slide. And I was happy about that, because it's a project that, when it was expressed, kind of looks a little bit random and haphazard. But I think in design, there's a lot of kind of silent planning that goes on that's never expressed. And I think that's one of the difficult things about our job, is trying to communicate that to people, both clients, but also like to communicate that to like the layperson, the value in design is all the thinking that you don't see. It's all the crumpled stuff in the trash can. I save all my process, so it's all under my bed. It's that stuff that you don't see that's so valuable. And like, this is one of my favorite drawings from that project. It's just a CAD drawing, but it's trying to figure out a system for establishing something that doesn't appear systematic.
Mm-hmm.
It's that's the detail that I think sets design off for me. When you're in design school, for me, I wasn't that keen on like the idea of doing construction documents, like figuring out how everything went together. It's kind of abstract because I'd never done it. And once I did it, I realized that's a whole nother kind of, that's a door you open, and you open it up, and there's another door, another door, and it becomes kind of consuming. And this was a fun drawing to kind of go down that rabbit hole in.
Yeah, I mean, I guess a lot of the things that I pulled speak so much more to process than mm-hmm. a finished outcome, and I think that I was really interested in how you, just the different approaches to visualization, mm-hmm. and I guess just thinking about all those different ways to talk about hierarchy and space, like, mm-hmm. This is something I guess I would have never necessarily thought about mm-hmm. when thinking about physical space, yeah. but thinking about it through like typographic hierarchy yeah. was really exciting to me. And I guess maybe also as a graphic designer, like I was able to understand it in a different mm-hmm. way.
Thanks. This was a project that I worked on. A friend of mine had a gallery in town over in Oregon Hill and set up a design exhibit there where each one of us took a plot in Manchester and designed a house for it and constructed a new neighborhood. And I've always been fascinated with the row houses in Richmond. But there's a limitation to that type, mm-hmm. that housing type. You got the windows in the front, you've got some windows in the back, you've got a big dark space in the middle. You've got a series of parlors that at one time were really useful, but now are kind of antiquated and they're kind of like your appendix. They're not really used for anything. And so I wanted to do an analysis of how it works, but how do I kind of describe that in a way that's not just a sketch or a diagram? Mm-hmm. And so this was kind of my attempt at that. The row house type has, as it evolved, doesn't kind of suit the way we live now. Mm-hmm. And so my first step with any kind of process is trying to analyze what's there, what is. And until you kind of articulate what is, you can't kind of move from there. Mm-hmm. And so anytime you can look at it in a slightly different way, I think it triggers any time you can shift media, it triggers a different way of understanding that. And so I'd never really done this before, so it was an experiment that I enjoyed. Mm-hmm. This was a project that evolved from that. And so one of the things that I noticed about Richmond row houses is they're really kind of facade houses. You've got the front face, which you see, and then after that, the side, the back, are pretty much either ignored or just very utilitarian. And if you look in the fan, the quality of material on the front is different. As soon as you turn the corner, you see a different type of brick. And so there's a metaphor, I think, in there for like appearances and what happens behind the space. And so the houses are really facade houses. And so my goal with this is, how do you make a house that has as many facades as possible? And so in doing that, we can address kind of the surface quality of houses, row houses, by wrapping that surface, making every surface of the house important, but also address some of the limitations of a row house in that if we break it up and reintroduce more daylight, then more of those spaces in the interior become viable spaces for spending time in. And so this became like instead of a house with a facade, kind of a facade house, the mm-hmm. whole, as many faces as I could squeeze in there. It also became like an experiment for different media. I like mixing things, so there's Photoshop, and there's markers, and there's CAD, and there's color pencil. And so I'm interested in those kind of hybrids. I try to preach that when I teach, that there's no one way to do something. It's all kind of a mixture and a hybrid. And the more you can kind of combine things, the more unique kind of expressions you can find. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, you'll find the one that's right for what you're doing and how you're doing it. So that's kind of the origin of that. It was a great process to be part of, to work with. Again, we were all working with individual projects, but then we're trying to connect them to 12 other designers. Mm-hmm. And it's the juxtapositions that happen, the serendipitous ones, the intended ones. That's one of the things that's interesting about architecture for me. Mm-hmm. I think one of the things that really changed the way I thought about architecture was my first trip to Rome. And not because it sent me back into classicism is the way it should be. But you go to a place like Rome, and things, it's like 4,000 years of juxtaposition, and it all works together. Even though if you really stop and look at things, you'll see things that span hundreds and hundreds of years in one block. But they're doing things that key from one to the next that allow individual things, individual expressions to coexist with expressions that have been there for many, many years before that. And it was being there and seeing that, it's like any kind of homogeneity that you see in a neighborhood is kind of contrived. Mm-hmm. That people are diverse, people's experiences change. The way we live today is different from the way we lived 50 years ago, different from the way we lived 100 years ago. And if we don't express that, we're being dishonest in terms of how we're reflecting culture. And so that joyful combination of things is one of the things that keeps me coming back to design. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, I like those juxtapositions of different schools of thought, mm-hmm. different like formal qualities, mm-hmm. like all those ideas of like, I love going to cities where you walk down the street and there's a postmodern house sort of butted up against, you know, maybe a postbellum mm-hmm. house, or I mean, you know,
and it doesn't
that
always
kind
work.
Of common, yeah,
right.
But I like that.
Absolutely, because it might not work, but you know, in some cases it will work. And people use that excuse, well, look at that, it looks totally, doesn't look like it fits in. Maybe not right now.
Yeah.
It will. And if we don't try that, we'll never figure out how to do it. If we retreat back into something safe, I want to know, like, when my son grows up and looks back at things I've built, I want him to see an attempt to, like, express who we are. Mm-hmm. And if we negate that, I don't know what we're doing. Mm. So.
Oh, you can take this now.
Awesome. I wanted to ask you about your website, because okay. with the work that you do, the way you present on the website, there's a connection there. Like, my website is an opportunity to show work. I want people to see the kind of things I've done. But you do things that are interactive. You make videos, you make websites. And so your website is kind of part of that. And I wanted to, one of the things that I'm curious about your work is it seems to purposefully violate convention. Mm-hmm. You know, the squiggles and the sparkles. And can we get this to open up?
Yeah.
And so, like, your name has got the glitter. You've got this interesting coding where you've got things overlaying with the images. Like, what do you see as a relationship between how you present your work and the work?
I mean, I guess the website now, it's funny, like, I'm in the process of, it's gonna look completely different, but this has been up, I guess, for the last four years or mm-hmm. something, and I wanted the website to just kind of be, like, you could kind of know what you were going to get right when you got there, uh-huh. Because I think that at least for this stuff I'm doing, I didn't want to have this sort of clean interface where, I mean, it's still really clean and traditional, yeah. but just the fact that I'm using like balloon glitter default right. text, uh-huh. you know, like I made that on a text generator online. Like there's little cues to like that's intentional,
right?
You know, and sort of the small graphic overlays, like, it's like pointing to very traditional graphic design things, but mm-hmm. then, at least for me, trying to explain like in a very visual way, like the things that I'm interested in, mm-hmm. interests that like I think have to do a lot with taste mm-hmm. and judgment,
right.
you know. So mm-hmm. that was the initial like concern when I redid my website. Like mm-hmm. before that, it was just white left-hand column. Names of projects
right.
organized by like professional, personal, exactly. and I felt like it was really hard for me to figure out where things went and make it feel like honest or something.
It's interesting too for me to look at it, because like so much of the world is square-spaced now. Like you look at a website and all right, I've seen that template. It's clean, it looks fine, but it's so ubiquitous, there's almost no personality. there's no distinguishing. I see the same Obama font on everything. I love the font, but you see it everywhere. And kind of undermining that or critiquing that, you make something kind of unique.
Mm-hmm.
Can I?
Yeah.
I chose this one because it's maybe the most traditional 2D kind of thing that I found in your work, and I was curious, like, where this came in your evolution,
mm-hmm.
and how you saw the influence of it on your work, where you're going.
So this was for a show in LA, and the show was called Neo Nonsense. Mm-hmm. And I was paired with two other artists. One actually, my friend that I was telling you, is the footwear designer,
yeah.
who was really like exploring strange materials and that juxtaposition to make sort of like nonsensical functional like cups.
Mm-hmm.
And then a photographer who was working more in painting, but like really interested in sort of the grotesque in cartoons.
Mm-hmm.
So we all knew each other in grad school, and I was invited into the show. And at the time, I guess something that I'm really interested in is understood structures. So the fact that we can look at objects or spaces or like even very specific like color palettes,
mm-hmm.
and those give us like a specific, like not memory, but you know, when people look at this, they say, oh, it's like the mall.
Right.
You know,
yeah.
And that was something that I wanted as an entry point.
Mm-hmm.
So I liked that idea that I could use really understood everyday structures, just like the poster display,
right.
and kind of explore that maybe as a different exploration of the book,
mm-hmm.
but also like as a way to interact with an object and maybe transport you a little from being in a gallery to like shopping.
Yeah.
And that being really funny to me.
Mm-hmm.
So this was like 3 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And there were 20 images that I created. Mm-hmm. So they're archival inkjet prints, but then they're like, you know, stuck behind plastic.
Right.
So they're really nice prints. The color is super beautiful,
right.
but then they're, you know, stuck behind plastic. And so that kind of push and pull for me was really interesting. To play with.
The mall comes up later in another slide.
Yeah.
Like, were you a mall person?
No, I wasn't. I know. All my friends were.
Uh-huh.
Like, my friends were allowed to go to the mall and hang out.
Uh-huh.
I was not, because that meant I would have, like, been without parental supervision. Yeah. But I really like the idea of graphic design as this vehicle that we use to, like, identify ourselves as things.
Mm-hmm.
So especially if you look at youth culture, you buy something because it represents you.
Yeah.
I mean, we still do that, but
absolutely.
You see that so much more crystallized in subculture,
mm-hmm.
like a goth.
Yeah.
Like a goth kid, you can tell is a goth kid,
right.
no matter if they're like walking down the street or in their parents' house. And like style is as a way to talk about ideology.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I was like really interested in the mall as like this place where that happens.
Right.
You know, like you're trying to revolt, but like you're still under your parents' roof.
Mm-hmm.
And like that kind of humor, but like also like that, how do you rail against those structures that you're kind of in?
And I grew up in the mall centric kind of place.
So did I.
And like, if you're trying to differentiate yourself, the only option you have to differentiate yourself is the mall, where everything is available to everybody. And it's such a strange kind of place to vibrate in as a kid. You're trying to distinguish yourself, but at the same time, everyone is hanging out the same place. And so I'm very curious how that kind of aesthetic kind of pops in through the work, or I see things that remind me of that kind of, that time.
Yeah.
So let's look at some. I remember talking to you a little bit about this last year, And I was really curious if you could speak a little bit more this piece of writing that you did. One of the things I really appreciate about your work is you have these interactives, you have the web stuff, you have the print stuff, but then you also have this really intense critical body as well. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about this and how it fits into your overarching kind of aesthetic.
Well, I guess I never really was interested in writing until I went to grad school, and we didn't have any classes or grades, but the thing that we did have was critique and reviews. And we wrote reviews for each other, and those were, you know, like 4 to 5 pages long, where we were pulling in theory and having to support our judgment of the work and our interpretation. Mm-hmm. And I found that, as with anyone, like when you critique work, you bring your own baggage. So you find things that you're inspired by, and you use that to like talk about someone else's work. And so I just really fell in love with writing in grad school. Mm-hmm. And I felt like there were things that I was thinking about that maybe weren't necessarily going to manifest in my visual work, but I still wanted to explore them.
Right.
And so I find that those things, kind like my writing really feeds into what I make. And then sometimes I make something and then I think about how like I would approach that through words.
Right.
And sometimes then I use those words in like a video or something. Mm-hmm. So that has been something that over like the past, I guess probably since I've been at VCU, mm-hmm. has been like a really like exciting, but also like really hard thing to work through.
Yeah. Do you ask your students to write?
Sometimes. Yeah. I more so like reading and discussion, mm-hmm. and usually giving readings that aren't about graphic design, and then talking, like trying to have a conversation about how this reading either applies to something in their daily life,
mm-hmm.
How does it apply to design, but the stress being on being a person who's culturally literate.
Mm-hmm.
And that means whatever you want that to mean. High culture, low culture, mall culture,
mm-hmm.
reality television. Like, mm-hmm. I feel like if you don't pay attention to those things as a designer or as an artist, as a human being, like you're doing a disservice to like the people you interact with.
Yeah.
So I try to like, you know, we'll read Barts, but we'll also like read like a piece on like, I don't know, I can't think off the top of my head of like some of the things but you know, we'll watch like a movie that maybe is like critiquing like public access television, but it's also really funny,
right.
You know, so.
One of the best classes I took in grad school is a landscape class, but it wasn't, I remember the professor Jose Garcia said, if you're coming here to do shrubberies, this is not the class for you. We just looked at the American landscape through cinema.
Uh-huh.
And so it was like 1 week we'll watch Clerks and talked about the edge condition. Next week we watch Wim Wenders, Paris, Texas.
That's so cool.
And so you've got these kind of juxtapositions of these all valid views, mm-hmm. of what it means to be in this culture today. And I think like encouraging people to pay attention to, if you want to use high and low.
Yeah.
Is really important. We start to get a little segregated, I think, in our culture, like smart things, like reality TV things, and it becomes fractured. Everything's fractured, but it's all part of the same continuum.
Mm-hmm.
If we ignore one, then we're limiting the understanding of the other.
Yeah.
And so that kind of being able to bring those things together, encourage kind of how does it relate, is a really valuable teaching thing. And one more kind of print thing that I wanted to talk about. And so this is a collaboration that you made.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a journal of your.
It's called Issues, and it's an annual publication that I publish with a friend of mine. Her name's Sarah Faith Gottesdiener. She's based in LA.
Mm-hmm.
We met through Christina, the shoe designer again, uh-huh. The sneaker designer, but we had a couple friends in common that kept saying, you two should meet. We started an email conversation kind of, you know, about her experience in graduate school, my experience, kind of what we felt was lacking in the conversation at the time a few years ago. And we decided that we wanted to make something together. And so kind of initially as a joke, we were like, let's call it Issues. And we're like, we have issues. And we decided that it would be a place for us to showcase writers, artists, designers, female and or queer identified, that we think should be, like, their work should be shown. And so the first issues, there's a lot of contributors, and there wasn't necessarily like a theme. We just kind of invited a bunch of people that we were excited about. With the second issues that came out this past February, the topic was of space, and so making space, taking up space, digital analog space, but you know, more focused on a topic. So the next one's going to be on failure. And we sort of let them take up as much space in the publication as they want, and propose, or like, you know, give us existing work. But I don't know, it's probably my like favorite project that I'm working on, just because I feel like we're putting something out that we feel we weren't really seeing in the publications we see at the book fairs that we go to. And
when did you meet Christina?
Sarah and I started exchanging emails when I lived in Minneapolis, so about 5 years ago, and then we did the first issues February of 2015. We started fall of 2014.
Like that compatriot or comrade in arms, for me, there was a guy in grad school where it's just finally like, yes, can we talk about something like this?
Yeah.
And having that kind of community for me was huge. It gave some voice to kind of things that I've been thinking about, but I didn't have a venue to talk about them. How is it kind of continuing that relationship over the distance?
It's hard. Yeah. It's only a 3-hour time difference, but being on two different coasts, and she's, you know, adjunct teaching at a bunch of places, and she has all these other like practices. It can be really hard coordinating our schedules, but so we decided it's an annual publication. Like, we will release one. Right now we do just 100 copies. But it's like a labor of love. Like, it's really stressful when we're doing it, because we may not, you know, I might send her an email and not hear back from a couple days, or vice versa. But I think we keep tabs on each other, and we want the publication to not just talk about diversity, we want it to be that. So I think when we start, we have like a spreadsheet of all the people we want to include, and then we talk about like why this person is important, like why their voice is important. And I think it's good because it's both of us doing it. So it's not just my buddies or like the people I see on the internet.
Right.
You know, she has a totally different group of like colleagues on the West Coast. And so we're constantly sharing work that we see with each other, and sometimes including students as well, which I think is really fun.
Absolutely. I think the next one, a series of videos that you've made. And I was curious, I don't know if we can play this. This one that just has white noise.
Yeah.
Over it. I'm curious, like, going from graphic design, which you traditionally think about as 2D and static, bridging over to kind of KI or cinema, or I don't know that labels are all that important or useful, but what kind of pushed you in this direction?
Well, this video is kind of funny because it was part of a flag show. So my friend Lauren Thorson, who also teaches here, Lauren put on this show called Flag Show and invited a bunch of people to make flags for imagined nations, but also create a weather report for that nation. So it was this funny thing where I made this flag for the United Nations of Magical Girls. And I had to make a weather report for that. But I was, at the time, like in a lot of net art shows, and most of the people I was talking to about my work lived in all these different places, maybe places I didn't, you know, like maybe they didn't even live in the places that I thought they did. Mm-hmm. But so for me, this was like, I was gonna make a weather report for the internet. Uh-huh. And that's kind of where it started. And it tied in with this flag that I had made. Yeah.
What was the nature of the show?
It was just flags. Like it was.
Was it a physical show?
It was a physical show, but every artist made a video that was inspired by, I think it's David Lynch's weather videos on YouTube.
All right. Yeah, I haven't seen those.
Yeah, where he's just looking into the camera, telling you what the weather is outside. And so I was thinking about how would I describe what the weather is if I'm on the internet?
Right.
Because for a while on my bio, when someone would ask me for that, I would just say Nicole Killian is from the internet, because I was moving a lot and that felt like it made more sense at the time.
When you I don't know if you show this to students or if you have discussions with students about it. How do you talk about something like that doesn't fit like a conventional form? And I guess we could talk about the next one too. Sorry.
In terms of conventional form, I think this one has sound, but I'll just talk over it. I think a lot about form.
There is a series at the fashion boutique. There is a sale at the electronics store and at the phone store.
Attention mall shoppers. There is a clearance at the computer store. There is a sale at the fashion boutique and at the sunglasses boutique.
This goes on for a while, just like this. I talk about how, form. I talk about how form is linked to content. Mm-hmm. So for me, those things can't be separate. So I'm very specific in what I choose when I'm talking about something. Mm-hmm. That audio is actually from a board game I had as a kid that was called Mall Madness, where you basically shopped, and there would just be alerts, and you had your credit card, and it would tell you to move around the mall to buy things. So that was where that audio comes from. That's exactly how the game sounded. But yeah, so for me, I'm looking at these specifically typographic forms because I think as a graphic designer, we have an initial knee-jerk reaction to certain things based on judgment values and taste. Mm-hmm. And I guess for me, I revel in that more. It's not a guilty pleasure, it's just pleasure.
Right.
And I think that those sort of default tools are really easy ways for people to express themselves. Mm-hmm. Specifically on the internet, when you look at the glitter text, that stuff, if you just Google glitter text generator, pages and pages of links pop up and you can make your language visible. Right. And so that is something that I think for a while I was just really fascinated by. Mm-hmm. I still am, but at the time when I was doing this, I was really loving this idea of the democratization of graphic design. Mm-hmm. And it's not a bad thing, it's a good thing that people can do this.
Right. Maybe we could take a look at the next video.
X that out.
All right, this is a little different kinetic. I think if you click on this, we can get to the, whoops. Sorry. Wait, that was me. Sorry.
That's you. Okay, yeah. So if I click on this.
Yeah, I think if you click on that. Is this the best way to look at this, or would it be better to go to the link?
That's like a video that they made of a video that I made.
Right.
They do this tableau for like all the videos.
Gotcha.
But it's pretty.
Actually, John, if you could scroll over, if you see the link bottom left.
Yeah.
Actually, if you go to the other, there you go, that one. Awesome. This one's from your time in Finland.
Yeah.
And so the imagery here is much different, but you still see some of the similarities in terms of kind of the automated things and mm-hmm. and like things that typically, like when you're talking about the knee jerk with mm-hmm. respect to typographic forms, like the gradient,
mm-hmm.
like, that would be something in critique where someone would be like, oh, you don't want to use a gradient like that.
Mm-hmm.
But you're kind of employing and juxtaposing things here. Mm-hmm. Like, how did this series come about?
So when I was in Finland, I was shooting footage. So to preface,
yeah.
I had been writing something that I've been interested in is this like topic of girls that run in packs. Mm-hmm. That can be women, girls, queer people. But thinking about this idea of like when people come together like to create community and how that is viewed by society, but like where also points in popular culture where we see this. Mm-hmm. And so I was writing about Sailor Moon, Tumblr girls, witches on like 90s television mm-hmm. and film, the women's building in the 80s at CalArts, just like these different points in time where this like community building is very present mm-hmm. and where graphic design / visual culture are like at the crux of that
mm-hmm.
that conversation. So when I was in Finland, I went and I was like in the woods.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a nature person, so I felt like this residence, A, was my first residency, and B, I was putting myself in like a really weird place. Like, I'm definitely a city kid.
Yeah.
So to be in a space where like, what am I gonna make when like, I'm pretty much only ever thinking about the internet
mm-hmm.
Or on the internet.
Yeah.
So still thinking about that girls that run in packs thing, but also like really into the idea of like of technology as like a spiritual device
mm-hmm.
And sort of like just playing with that as matter. I shot footage of these objects that I was making from like sticks and rocks in the woods. And then also shooting footage of all the women that were at the residency with me and sort of only giving them cues to like, here is a wand, here is an object. Use this object as you would your smartphone, but it's just it's just like a rock.
Right.
And so thinking about them as like gazing stones or like mm-hmm. this idea of gazing and like sort of meditating on an object.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the things that I was playing with the most while I was there.
Mm-hmm. You talked about going from high school, going into RIT, graphic design, kind of a way to kind of do art in maybe a more practical way. The politics of gender are run through your work. Where did that kind of start to influence the way you were looking at
when I worked at MTV and Nickelodeon?
How so?
Well. Specifically at Nickelodeon, I was mostly designing for preschool
mm-hmm.
And then stuff for like live action television.
Okay.
And gender politics would come up like in the most overt ways. Like I'm not talking about just like, slightly, but I mean just in terms of color,
mm-hmm.
like do's and don'ts on just like form.
Uh-huh.
Oh, like this cannot be for girls, this cannot be for boys. And I think, I'm just looking at like pop culture and like how graphic design becomes a support structure to like represent gender
right.
on television. I would be doing my stuff at like MTV News or like, working at Nick Jr. And then I'd go home and I found that I was making all this other stuff that was coming from the things I was thinking about while I was at work,
mm-hmm.
but I just needed to do them in a different way.
Right.
So I would say it started in the early to late 2000s mm-hmm. when I was working in New York.
Mm-hmm. Well, once you start to see those kind of things, can you turn them off?
No.
Yeah.
No, and it's funny too. I think for anyone who's ever worked in television, like after you work in television and you watch TV and like you just watch like news graphics, or it's just like funny because you think about like the people who are making it, and like, I don't know, it's just you just see like a different side of how that stuff is built, or like who's making the decisions on even like what that font is, or the, you know, the colors, or all that kind of stuff. Like there are committees upon committees that talk about that stuff, and then you're sort of in the middle of it, trying to like kind of stake your claim, and or like even just kind of do good, and like where you fall in that process maybe isn't always the best, but it's like, it's definitely like an interesting place.
Yeah. I think Johnny might have to take me back to the slide. Sorry. And this piece is one of your more recent pieces, I believe. Mm-hmm. And like in terms of color, in terms of content, it's very different from some of the early ones we saw. Mm-hmm. And so what does this represent in terms of how your work is evolving?
This was I made this while I was in Norway, and it was the first time I was making something that was very connected to place, physical place, not like digital or the internet. Mm-hmm. And so all the footage is from Norway. Mm-hmm. And I was there, and living in Richmond, like it was kind of mind-blowing to go to a city where there were so many representations in public statues of women, and not just young women, but aging women, mothers. Like that was pretty mind-blowing to like see statues sort of like celebrating mothers, you know, things like that. And so I was doing research, and the project was called Colette because I was doing research and found out that one of the like females that was studied, her name was Colette. So I named the project after her. Mm-hmm. But this was sort of my response to being there. It was gray and rainy. It was a slow and beautiful city, and so this was sort of that Norway, like Oslo embodied for me, and sort of looking at that study of all the statues.
Mm-hmm. Like you talk about the readings that you bring into your classes. You talk about purposefully going outside of design to look at those readings. Given kind of the tenor of the political discourse of the fall, your work kind of looking at gender construction, gender roles. How do you see like you're so connected to like internet as a place, and so much of the kind of conversation about gender this political season takes place in this kind of like this place. And how have you kind of responded to that? How is that kind of, do you see it creeping into your work? Is it something that you can kind of digest? Is it something that you see as an influence? Or is it just too noisy?
I feel like we're all gonna have PTSD from this election series season. I think it more means that it's like that much more important to have conversations on race and gender, just like physical bodies, like beings in space, and like how we have to like reckon with our differences and accept them, and also like think about that power in like finding people that support you, finding people that have had the same lived experiences as you, like, and acknowledging when you have differences, not just like saying like we're all the same, or you know, like, right. Because that actually like erases people's experience. So I find that it creeps a lot into our discussions in class, because how could it not if everything we see is so saturated with political conversation. Mm-hmm. But I think that makes sense. I mean, like we were saying, if you're, I think specifically in graphic design or in design in general, like there is this idea of audience or communication. And so if you are not paying attention to that and you're pretending like you're in a vacuum, like what's the point of saying you're a designer? Yeah. So I think it manifests in students are coming to class and we're bringing up actual conversations on like important shit, that's, you know, awesome. Not just like the kerning of something or like make it bigger or, right. you know, do you like this logo redesign? Like right. that's, I think that would be like such a disservice to an academic space where it should be like about free thought. So that's how I feel it's affecting like the classroom.
It's really gratifying to kind of hear that it's having that kind of something that's so, in so many cases can be so base.
Yeah.
Actually generate something positive. I think I have two more slides. I was wondering if you could talk about these two.
Sure.
We got this one and then I believe one more.
Yeah, so this project is called Deep Inside My Inbox. And it is a collaboration with artist A.L. Steiner, who was visiting faculty in sculpture last year. We were both asked to be in a book show, but we didn't want to make anything physical. Mm-hmm. So we talked about collaborating and just kind of rethinking what a book could be. So there's maybe like 300, 400 images here that we kind of collected. It's sort of an archive of maybe months of conversation. And using that, initially at the show, when you would click on the gradient envelope in the corner, a unique PDF of the website would be sent to you. So sort of reconfiguring the archive as book every time. And so every time you refresh the page, the archive gets mixed up again. So every time you approach it, it should be a different space. And so like playing with public, private, mm-hmm. That's sort of the short, you know, description of the project.
Because it strikes me, someone who works in the media that you do, how you kind of translate that to a static kind of medium is always a challenge. And so it's kind of like a random book generator.
Yeah.
I think we have one more website. Let me, when you started off your conversation like thinking, oh, I could design CD covers, things like this, I guess this is kind of the closest thing to that.
Oh, okay. So this is also a collaboration with photographer Charlie White. Mm-hmm. And this is from 2012. Mm-hmm. I met Charlie when I was a grad student at Cranbrook. He was one of my favorite artists, and I drove him to the airport, and like we had a good conversation. He's like, keep in touch. So we kept in touch over a few years, and at one point he was working on this project called Music for Sleeping Children, mm-hmm. And he said, you know, I'm getting a bunch of different artists involved. I think that we could collaborate on something, or you could make a piece. Mm-hmm. And so we talked about this Tumblr site being sort of a backdoor into the project. So there was a website for Music for Sleeping Children that was very much more designed for gallerists, the art world. It was clean, it explained the album, the process. It was an album, six different teenagers were interviewed. He makes his work in LA, where most people want to be actresses or actors. And basically a pop album was made to the interviews. Okay. And it was a free download online. Mm-hmm. And so this space started as sort of an archive where it's critiquing the structure, but it also is the structure. Mm-hmm. And so there's a lot that just kind of seems like a normal Tumblr, and then hoping that there's these points of crisis where there's kind of something that doesn't seem that not so right in the mix, and that can just be something similar.